It's always a pleasure to be there in TIACON. And thank you, Bansi Bhai. And nice meeting you, Alok. And we do chat quite a lot, maybe every month or so. So without wasting much of the time, I'll directly go to the topic proper. So my talk today is on meaningful monitoring of your patient with type 2 as well as type 1 diabetes. It has not been specified. Thank you, Bansi Bhai. Thank you, DiaCare team. Thank you, everyone. This is a session which has been sponsored by LifeScan. So it has all the scientific support is going to has come from them. Now, we know that hyperglycemia is important, and I'll just take one slide here that how it is not only the fasting blood glucose, it is not only the postprandial blood glucose, but it is also glycemic variability, which is equally important and need to be taken care. So hyperglycemia is certainly very, very important for all of us. And there can be fasting hyperglycemia, there can be postprandial hyperglycemia. This chronic hyperglycemia will lead to naturally more amount of formation of the glycation AGs and will lead to micro as well as macroangiopathy. Similarly, if you have more glycemic variability, high peaks and high valleys, even that there's those situation causing glycemic variability in activation of the oxidative stress or ROS formation and leading to diabetic complication. And it is utmost important that hyperglycemia need to be treated and need to be addressed for. But equally important is hypoglycemia. Even a single episode of hypoglycemia to a person with type 1 diabetes or type 2 diabetes on insulin or oral drugs will certainly shatter their life. And they have so much of phobia of hypoglycemia if they have moderate to severe hypoglycemia, even once in life. And that is why hypoglycemia need to be addressed. We should also be aware that hypoglycemia unawareness is very much prevalent, especially in type 1 diabetes or those with chronic type 2 diabetes, those who are on insulin therapy, those who have very tight glycemic control, long duration of diabetes because of autonomic neuropathy. And DCCT trial as well as other trials have shown that 50% of type 1 diabetes may have hypoglycemia unawareness of the long duration. And severe hypoglycemia episode occurs almost 50% times during the sleep and one third time during the day without warning. And it is more pertaining to elderly people, those who have pre-existing coronary artery disease or cardiovascular disease, and these patients and those who are on beta blockers. So it is more pertaining to them. And that is why, whether it is hyperglycemia, whether it is hypoglycemia, it need to be addressed. And that is why we should be monitoring blood glucose very, very closely. Now, monitoring of blood glucose is one of the fundamental part of the therapy when it comes to management of type 1 or type 2 diabetes or pregnancy diabetes. But what is important word here is, which I want to emphasize, is meaningful monitoring. So it has to be structured. It has to be giving you some message so that you can take some action. And it should not be haphazard that you are just doing blood glucose for the sake of nothing. And sometimes the patient does wonderful monitoring system, but doctor does not have time to see that. Even both things has to be properly addressed. So what do we mean by monitoring? Monitoring is the systematic process of collecting, analyzing, and using this information to track a program's progress. Now, program progress in this case is maybe a therapeutic actions or dietary actions or the physical activity profile action to be taken on the basis of these blood glucose monitoring towards reaching its objective. That means your target of the glycemic control, how should we reaching it without causing hypo or hyperglycemic spikes, so that we can it guides us for the management decision. That is what is a theoretical definition of monitoring. So what we know about monitoring: the strict glycemic control can decrease number of progression of macro as well as microangiopathy in both type 1 type 2 diabetes, and SMBG is a self-monitoring of blood glucose, a cornerstone to the diabetes management. Now, but despite 40 years of self-monitoring of blood glucose, we are still connecting the dots. We are not able to connect the dots. Now, patients with diabetes are not receiving self-management education, and education plays a major role. So what's a finger pricks? What do my numbers mean? What do I do with them? What do I check? What am I aiming for all these answers are still not being received by all our people with diabetes. And that is why one of the reason in our country that 75% of the people with diabetes are still uncontrolled, only 25% have achieved their targets. So if we educate our people with diabetes for the structured monitoring of blood glucose and a meaningful monitoring, possibly they will be able to take actions, and such actions will bring them to their targets. So helping people with diabetes to use the information from their monitoring in more meaningful way, modify their behavior, enhance their ability to self-adjust therapy, help them to decide about this, seeking medical assistance when it is required. They should know what is short-acting insulin. They should know what is long-acting insulin. They should know about Somogyi. They should know about Dawn. All these things should be taught, should be a part of education, so that the blood glucose which is being measured, the action can be taken properly. And we do come across with such cases. Patients are monitoring blood glucose for 3 months. They come to you after 2 or 3 months with a lot of blood, fasting, hyperglycemia, pre-lunch, post-lunch, all hyperglycemic state 300, 400, but they have not taken any action. They said, doctor, you told us to monitor. We are monitoring it, but we have not been taught how should we be taking action if your blood glucose is high. Neither he has contacted you. So a structured self-SMBG occurs when the clinician and the patient. So we have to involve patient in this whole program for both express their willingness and are motivated to perform the entire process, possess the knowledge to interpret the glucose level correctly, understand the pattern, and take the appropriate action towards achieving a good glycemic control. So structured intervention based on SMBG data will be covering on structured testing, pattern analysis, and how do you take the action towards those readings. Like this is one of the structured SMBG regimen, which is called a staggering method, that on Monday you do two fasting, pre-fasting and maybe post-breakfast. Second day you do pre-lunch, post-lunch. Third day you do Wednesday, you can do pre-dinner, post-dinner. Again, you go back like this, and once in a week you can have, so it can be a staggering method. It can be meal-based, pre- and post-meal blood glucose on any of the days. It can be even one test per day. Also 6 different days, you can have 6 monitoring of fasting, pre-lunch, post-lunch, pre-dinner, post-dinner, 3 a.m. in the morning. So you have a full week profile that how are you running out, how are you behaving as per your glycemic control is concerned. And what is the difference between the structured versus unstructured self-monitoring of blood glucose? Structured SMBG is beneficial in newly diagnosed type 2 diabetes, improves glycemic control in poorly controlled diabetes, especially type 2, improves postprandial glycemic control, associated with reduced cardiovascular risk, as well as improves the glycemic control and better HbA1c. There are good data available that the same dose of medicine, by simply monitoring, you can have reduction in HbA1c. Now, before we go through that, I feel we should know that how do you see the accuracy of a glucometer, which is being, how do we test it? What are the monitoring tools we have to see whether we are the instrument we are using is accurate or not? So there is a system which is being actually defined by ISO 15197. This has been updated in 2013. That you should be they actually check the blood glucose, those reading which are less than 100 or more than 100. And if it is less than 100, they take plus minus of 15 milligram. If it is more than 100, plus minus 15%. And these readings are being then tested compared with the control or the standard. And this comparison reference, in total, 95% of all the test result must fall within a range. If it is less than 95%, we say that the glucometer is not accurate. So when you talk about this one touch reveal glucometer of LifeScan, what they have done in their own test, the 99% of the results were in this zone. Now this zone is A zone is more near to almost less than 95 A and the A as well as the B. So more near to the normal or comparator. And if it is A and B, it is acceptable. Here it is 99% of the results were in the zone of this consensus Parkes error grid. And this error grid, if it is A and B, it is acceptable. But someone who's falling more amount of readings are C, D, or E, that means we have to take some action on this glucometer. No effect on the clinical action. If the A and B is there, you can continue same thing. But if someone has C and D, in that situation, you'll have to take the action about the accuracy of the glucometer. Now, there can be many factors which can impact the reliability of the blood glucose reading, and they are called as interference. So including medications, it can result in clinically relevant false high blood glucose reading, potentially resulting in inappropriate clinical decisions. So there can be human error. It can be incorrect use of the glucometers, inappropriate storage of the strips. And I can give you one example. We have our small indoor facility here, and one of the fine day, our sister, the nurse, came and she said that she has got some readings which are coming, all of this reading coming very, very low. And I've morning everything was all okay, and then we go and saw the strips. They were using those alcohol swab, and there was one alcohol swab which was unfortunately kept inside the what was fallen down in inside the strip bottle, and all strips got spoiled and the readings were coming low. So this is not uncommon. This is a human error, and that is why we have to be even checking those things. Similarly, there can be inherent error of the accuracy of the glucometer itself. There can be one lot to another lot, vial to vial, strip to strip variations. Environment, you have a higher temperature or the humidity. If you have a high altitude, the blood glucose may be high. If you have a high humidity, the blood glucose is likely sometimes can be low. If you have high triglyceride, there can be false low. If you have high uric acid, then again you have false high. If you have high bilirubin, you can have false low. So all other conditions, many of these drugs can also interfere with the blood glucose readings. Some of them may give high, some of them may give you false low blood glucose. And that is why we should have some data that particular glucometer you're using should have the precision or accuracy data despite using the multiple doses. So polyformin diabetes is common. Diabetes associated with multiple comorbidities, I feel that in recent study in UK, over the age of 65, demonstrated that in last 20 years, the proportion of person taking more than 5 medications has increased from 12% to 50%. Now, every second person is on polypharmacy. Diabetes has shown that people with type 1 and type 2 take 5 to 8 different medications respectively. And in addition, patient may take some over-the-counter medications for short illness. And despite this, there is very limited information available on when you use these glucometers, whether they perform well. So let us see, do we have some data? This is an example here. Can polypharmacy result in falsely elevated readings? This is a 68-year-old lady, 26 years, history of diabetes, type 2 diagnosed. She was fit 42. Medical history, she has hypertension, dyslipidemia, osteoarthritis, she has CKD. She is on insulin, SGLT2 inhibitors, atorvastatin, lisinopril, hydrochlorothiazide, acetaminophen for short period, and excellent blood glucose correction 6.8. Blood glucose reading, she is doing blood glucose monitoring 4 times a day. She does all those possible things which should be done by a patient. She developed mild to mild upper respiratory infection. She was put on some medication like acetaminophen. And then she noted an increase in the fasting and postprandial blood glucose, and then insulin dose was increased because of that. On such several occasions, she ended up in severe hypoglycemia after that, moderate to severe hypoglycemia after increasing the dose. And then she has to again reduce the doses. She has to increase the carbohydrate in the diet and other things. So this was possibly a false high HbA1c because of the acetaminophen. So a unique, there is a wonderful data which was recently published in 2021 by Grandi et al. And this is an analysis of a unique post-marketing surveillance database that a glucose test strip demonstrated no evidence of interference and robust clinical accuracy irrespective of the prescribed medication status of a large cohort patient. So they have actually used one-touch ultra-vero glucometer strips. There are around 830 patients, almost one third of them were type 1 diabetes, 500 type 2 diabetes, and they wanted to see the clinical accuracy profile Of course, by using the same method, accuracy criteria, which I told you of 15197 to 2015, rather more updated ISO criteria. And what they found is they have used almost all classes of medications, antihepatic lipids, antidepressant, gastrointestinal, and all these things have been compiled. And they have seen even if you are multiple doses, the accuracy was maintained, irrespective of the medications which have been used. More important is this comprehensive analysis for this specific test platform has demonstrated there is no interference and robust clinical accuracy effect issue on the test strip, irrespective of the prescribed medication. So whether you use one medication, two medication, three medication, even up to more than eight medications, still the accuracy of the glucometer is being maintained. Now, such data actually brings our confidence up of using this particular method of monitoring in patient so as to have keep the accuracy maintained. So there is another update here because we are talking about technology. This blood glucose system now has a meaningful results. Gone those days that our patient used to write and register, they used to prepare the tables and they used to write it. And many of them used to, especially type 1 diabetes, try to cheat doctors by writing wrong readings despite they become on higher side. And they used to write wrong readings there. And that was also, the prevalence was quite high. Now you have a inherent system where the smartphones have provided a real opportunity to improve diabetes care by enabling patient and healthcare professional to exchange information. So you have a glucometer, which can be, data can be through Bluetooth, data can be entered, can go to your mobile in an app, which is specifically designed for this glucometer. And through this app, you can come out with multiple fields and you can actually learn about your blood glucose in multiple way, and even the how many times you have in hypo, hyper, your diet related, a lot of things in those fields. And in even at the clinic data, the same data can be again transferred to a doctor's your chamber, and you can see a data which is there when the patient comes beforehand. You will have a trained of a person having blood glucose in last 2-3 months when they have come last to you. So they have a Bluetooth enabled data. It can be downloaded in an app which is called as One Touch Reveal app, and it will give you multiple fields here. They have even the insulin dose you can write there. Carbohydrate you have taken, that you can write it, and you can also see in blue lows or normal or highs in red. So and then you can also have a compile pattern that how was the breakfast, how was the lunch, how was the dinner. So multiple fields can actually guide you that which meal is causing you giving you trouble, where we need to have the modification in our diet or physical activity pattern. You can also download this data on the healthcare professionals webpage once they have when they get it enabled to our system, and it will give you exactly that how many patients of you have the readings with you in last 90 days, what are the averages. Everything can be, you can have a comprehensive overview, a new patient or a old patient, diabetes type, how many of you have type 1 diabetes. So actually it is one of the tools which can even give you a data which can be used for even research. So how many patients there in that, and how many of them male, female, how many type 1, type 2, how is their blood glucose going, how is their therapy working, how many of them they are going on low, which is a time which most commonly they are going on low, they are going high. All these things can be compiled together and maybe even go for publication. So this is one of the One Touch Reveal web page, where again you can have multiple fields: patient summary, excursion analysis, adherence analysis, a logbook, pump settings if the person is on pump, and details of the days as well as week, and even intraday and interday can be seen. And patient summary report can also come. It can show you pattern. It can give you comparative statistics. It can give glucose excursions, as well as the daily view can be seen. So you have a logbook report, what you expect when the patient comes to a clinic. You can see glucose reading organized by patients, personalized schedule. trace the sequence, how it is going, how it's out of range or below range or time in range, or optional time stamp shows the exact time where it has been taken. So does this get reflected? Now, whatever data I have shown you, does these facilities or does use of this technology get reflected into the benefit in HbA1c reduction or the quality of life? So here is a paper, which was again a migraine paper, and it has shown, this is a PROMISE study, the improved the glycemic control observed in Indian patient type 2 after experiencing a glucose meter featuring a color range indicator. So they have used actually color sure technology. So there is a reduction of 1.2% of HbA1c in type 2 diabetes patients who are using OTV reveal flags over 12 weeks. So those who were using the app and they have found there's reduction in the HbA1c versus those who are not using the app. And they all agreed, the patient agreed that it made them consider to take actions when they're high or low. 100% healthcare professional agreed that it helped the patient to identify hypos. And also they have agreed that the patient has more inclined to act on low or high. So HbA1c reduction, recognition of hypo and hyper and taking proper action has been proved now formally through this research or this publication. So diabetes app related next text message from healthcare professional in conjunction with a new wireless glucose meter with color range indicator improves glycemic control in type 1 and type 2. So if you give the messages, text message to the patient, and that also works. Now here again, a comparative data which was published in 2017, and they again have around five UK sites, 128 patients switched over from the current blood glucose monitor to Veroflex, and few of them have half of them have used the app, half of them have not used the app, and they have found that the reduction in HbA1c again in UK population 0.5% and 0.1% when they have used app also. So additional reduction in the HbA1c when you use the glucometer with the app, when you just have used the new glucometer from the other glucometer, there is a reduction. So you have now data in favor of this, and this is like a CGM. Of course, they are SMBG reading, but you can see it looks like a continuous glucose monitoring readings, and you can act on such graphs according to blue is showing low, green is acceptable, and red is high. So report can, you can have all the excursions as I told you, and on these peaks and valleys, you can certainly have the action profile. So it is so now, even in COVID, I feel Sanjay has already alluded to this issue about use of such monitors or monitoring system in this COVID pandemic. Diabetes patients are greater risk. We know that COVID has tendency to worsen diabetes. We know it. People with severe COVID infections, such as those of intensive care unit, are particularly vulnerable for infections, and mucormycosis and other infections. I don't want to go too in detail of it. Immunosuppressive drugs like steroids and widely used other drugs may also affect the blood glucose profile. And we know that monitoring of blood glucose in ICU and even outside ICU with good glycemic control can certainly change the picture. So finally, the carry-on message from this presentation is use simple and specific steps at the patient's level of comprehension. Be sure that the patient can demonstrate the step of SMBG. Give your patient written recommendation for frequency and the time of the testing and desired results. Observe the self-managed SMBG procedure at follow-up visit. Ask your patient to assess the relationship of SMBG with exercise, their food habits, medication, and stress. Specify which blood glucose SMBG values are more problematic, especially hypoglycemia, and discuss solution with the patient. Also, they need to have a knowledge of the drugs which they are going to modify, especially when it comes to insulin, and even those drugs which are causing hypoglycemia, like sulfonylurea, they need to be told about it. Acknowledge that the patient for goals achieved. So if someone has achieved their goals, of that someone is doing wonderfully well, should always acknowledge it and recognize his efforts for monitoring blood glucose and achieving good glycemic control. So let me finish my talk with a statement: that self-monitoring of blood glucose is a tool it is not an intervention. Our people with diabetes should know to monitor blood glucose in a meaningful way. That is what is more important than just doing blood glucose for nothing. So we wish you a happy, healthy, and enjoyable Navaratra and Dasara. Let us also pray Almighty that the corona should remain away from us, our life, and third wave should not come. Always try to celebrate any occasion. Maybe it is the inauguration of DiaCare today, to cut the fruit and not cut the cake, and give a strong message to the population that hydrogenated fat coming from such pastries and cake is I feel not good. Rather use fresh fruits for any celebration. With this message, I stop here. Thank you. Thank you very much for your patience listening.